Okay, so this is the first talk of a series of seminar that I planned. The overall topic would be about the nova phenomena in the quantum Chromo matter. The first part for today, I will talk about the chiral magnetic effect and isobar collision. So what are they? I'm going to explain. So let me start with a general introduction. Given that this is the first talk of the series, and given that I'm assuming that there may be some students, like graduate or undergraduate students and a young postdoc, I would like to explain a little bit of the big picture. Essentially, I think what we're doing is a branch of physics called nuclear physics. We often probably say that we're exploring the heart of matter. Indeed, if you look at the physical world, it has a hierarchy of structures starting from normal material down to molecules, atoms at a scale of about 1/1,000,000th of a millimeter. So that's 10 to the minus 10 or so. But within the atom, of course, everybody knows that there is an atomic nucleus. Now this is about 5 order of magnitude smaller, on the order of 1/1,000,000,000th of a millimeter. Even though it looks very small, it's very important because over 99% of the mass, and which means also energy of an atom, would actually be in the nucleus. So that's certainly very, very important. So let's say it's like the heart of matter. A lot of nuclear physics today try to investigate how little particle that we call proton and neutrons bind together through nuclear force to form all kinds of nuclei, all kinds of nuclei, and also how they potentially form things like a neutron star. If you want to look even further into the structure of those particles like proton and neutrons, we know that there are quarks and gluons. So these are the ultimate building blocks of our nuclear physics world, quarks and gluons. They interact through a particular force, and that's described by something we call the quantum chromodynamics. Well, that's where we are, basically, within the very, very heart of matter. We will try to understand that particular world of nuclear physics. Now, let me say something about this basic theory. So the good thing, or the good news, is that we do have a fundamental theory for nuclear physics, and that's the quantum chromodynamics. It's the long abelian gauge theory of quarks and gluons. Quarks are like electrons, and gluons are like a photon in a very, very crude way. So they interact. They are very different from electromagnetism as well, and that's because gluons actually interact with themselves. And that makes all the difference. Perhaps the most remarkable feature, as many of you know, it's the so-called asymptotic freedom, which basically says that the interaction strength become very, very large when you go to low energy scale or at large distance. Now that's the basic scale for QCD, at the energy of about 200 MeV, or at the distance about that one Fermi size, which is roughly the size of a proton. That's where the quark mass becomes very hard. Even though that theory looks like simple, it's like a 1-9 Lagrangian, to solve it and understand its consequence is incredibly hard because of that feature. All right, and that's why Frank Wilczek, everybody knows, a famous Nobel laureate, said at the Quark Matters 2014 that our task today is to really understand the emerging phenomena in nuclear physics or QCD. By that he means that we do have that fundamental theory and we know it's correct and it's complete, but there are many, many features and consequences of that theory that we don't understand at all, like confinement, some asymptotic freedom, anomalies, instant tone, spontaneous symmetry breaking. So that's basically what keeps us busy in the nuclear physics. Well, I'm first only going to give you a couple examples. This is the most, perhaps one of the most obvious example, namely, we actually don't get to see the quarks directly. That's something we call confinement. It's really a non-predictable feature of QCD. The forces become so strong at low energy, which means around here, that all the quarks, anti-quarks, and the gluon, they are all bound together to become a counter-neutral object that we call hadron. hadrons are particles like proton and neutron and pions and so on. Those hadrons, of course, are made of quark. That's something we call quark model. However, the real question that is non-trivial is how many ways do we have to make those hadrons? Okay, what are possible? What are not possible? Why some are possible and some are not? So these all encode, of course, the secrets of QCD. And to answer those questions are not easy. Even today, you know, there are many, you know, collider or, you know, accelerator experiments that try to produce something we call exotic hadrons and try to understand how to make them, why they're made this way, and so on. So this is the one exciting frontier, I think, of nuclear physics today, you know, in the hadronic physics. I will come back to this topic much later in the third seminar. For now, let's just keep in mind that, you know, even like kind of a, you know, simple question like how quarks make hadrons are still not fully understood. We in the heavy ion collision field mostly try to cook up a quark soup. That's kind of a cartoon way of saying what we're trying to do. Basically, the idea is that you want to create, you know, or you want to, you know, make some external control of a nuclear matter, in particular the temperature. You want to change that, you know, temperature condition from our normal condition, which is kind of very, very low temperature, to a very hot, very high temperature environment. Why we want to do that? Well, by doing that, what will happen is that your thermal energy will create more and more of those hadrons, proton, neutron, pion, and everything. And eventually the hope that those, you know, they're so densely packed that they're going to overlap and, you know, the individual hadron boundary will disappear. And you should eventually get a large macroscopic system of quarks and gluons. And indeed, that idea was envisioned a long time ago, like at the end of 1970s. And it even was given a name by a quark gluon plasma by Edward Schuyark, who was my thesis advisor. And over, since then, a lot work had been done and try to understand what is a quark gluon plasma and how that kind of transition from our usual hadron gas to a quark gluon plasma would happen. One of the most powerful tool in doing that is something we call lattice QCD. So this is actually an example of lattice QCD calculation of thermodynamics, like a pressure, energy density, entropy density, and so on. It demonstrates a transition from hadronic degree of freedom to quark-gluon degree of freedom. There is also a basic feature that's called chiral symmetry, which is spontaneously broken in the QCD vacuum. That symmetry is also restored in the high temperature. So this is pretty much like ferromagnetism. If you have a piece of magnet, it has some particular magnetization, and that's essentially what we call a spontaneous symmetry breaking phenomenon. But if you heat that piece of magnet up to a high temperature, that magnetization will disappear. All right, so in a lot of ways that what we're doing are kind of condensed matter physics QCD. We try to understand a large system of quarks and gluons, and that helps us to understand the implication of the QCD interaction in a more direct way. Okay, so we say that we're expecting something like a quark gluon plasma at a very high temperature, but exactly how high? That has been figured out. It's on the order of 10 to the 12 degrees or Kelvin. And if you use the high energy unit, that'll be about 160 MeV or so. But that's a super hot temperature. You don't get that temperature in normal environment. Fortunately, we do have a way to create that kind of high temperature. And that's something we call heavy ion collision, of course. There are now two big experiments in the world. One is the Relativistic Heavy Ion Collider. The other is the Large Hadron Collider. In both of those colliders, you try to accelerate atomic nucleus to very, very, basically like near the speed of light, and then let them collide together. In that process, what happens, roughly speaking, is that the kind of kinetic energy of your initial fast-moving nucleus will turn into thermal energy, okay, upon collision. And that there's enough of thermal energy to create a hot, hot temperature that allow the creation of a quark gluon plasma. So this is the iconic image of the detection of such a collision event in the star collaboration detector. Each of these nine are representing a particle that has been identified in their detector. So basically, in the heavy ion collision, we can create a hot, a quark-gluon plasma, which is basically a new phase of matter, because in today's environment, we don't have this kind of matter in normal condition. The QGP or quark-gluon plasma actually is also an old phase of matter. Today the universe is kind of cold, and the kind of standard model of cosmic evolution tells us that our universe start from something like a Big Bang, and after the Big Bang, a huge amount of energy and had occupied the initial baby universe started expand quickly and cool down. Okay, but you can use some cosmic evolution model to trace back to the early time, and today, like somewhere here, like 10 to the 18 second after the Big Bang, that's where we are today. The temperature has been very, very cold, okay, on the order of 1 Kelvin. But if you trace that back to about microsecond after the Big Bang, like 10 to the minus 6, the temperature is hotter than 10 to the 12 K. And that's where our quark-gluon plasma basically dictated the whole universe, okay? So really the quark-gluon plasma is an old phase of matter. Heavy ion collision is perhaps the only venue for replicating and studying the early universe environment. Okay. So I think in that sense, it's also quite remarkable. Over the last 20 years, we have heavy ion physics program at the RIC and the RTC, and that have been extremely successful. Not only that we create this quark-gluon plasma, we're able to measure many of the properties and behavior of that plasma. Okay. But then, of course, there's a question of what's next. Okay, you the theory expect a exotic matter quark-gluon plasma. Now you create it, you find it, you measure it. What's next? Well, we know from condensed matter, colleagues, you want to dial all the knobs you have, right? Like in the condensed matter physics, you have a two-dimensional system. You try to add magnetic field. You have a three-dimensional conducting electron. You add a magnetic field. You suddenly see something that's called quantum Hoare effect. You have a superconductor or some conductor, and you try to add more and more kind of doping of different elements, and suddenly you can get a high temperature superconductor. And the latest example is this so-called bilayer graphene. Many of you have heard about this. You have a very nice one layer graphene, and then you put another layer, and you start to turn their alignment angle, and at some magic angle, suddenly you get really, really exotic property. So that's basically telling us that we have this heavy ion collision that creates an extremely hot and dense quark-gluon system. We want to play with that system. And one of the handles we have is to change the collision energy. Okay, at RTC and in RIC, you can do collision experiment over a very, very wide energy span, from the order of 10 GeV collision energy to 1,000 GeV collision energy. More recent that have been pushing down toward the other direction, like going down to 1 GeV in the star fixed target. And we have a number of planned experiments in the future that we are that are going to explore collision in this 1 to 10 GeV region, including, for example, here in China and other experiments worldwide. So that's exciting. What can that bring us? Well, that can bring us many interesting things. Basically, it's like navigating on a map of what I call the quantum Chromo matter. That means the macroscopic, material that is, governed by the quantum Chromo dynamics. Okay. What I just said about this RIC-RTC high energy collision is basically exploring a very high temperature environment, which is along this temperature axis. Okay. But if by doing the low energy collision, you can actually navigate into a new dimension where your baryon density becomes larger and larger. And that potentially can bring us something really remarkable, like a critical point or even a first order phase transition that could in principle be detected. And there's a very, very active ongoing physics program to explore this. In addition to that, there are other interesting laws that you can have that allow you to navigate into different dimensions and see what happened in those kind of quantum Chromo matter. For example, you can think about what happened for this matter, this quark-gluon plasma, if you apply a large, very large magnetic field or large rotational vorticity field or a chirality imbalance between your left and right, in the last case, what if you try to dope your plasma with something that are not thermal, like impurity, like a charm quark. So all these bring interesting possibilities. In this series of seminar, I will discuss a number of those examples, okay? Like the many nova dimensions for exploring the quantum chromatic matter. So the first example is so-called paramagnetic effect. Okay, I will briefly explain what a paramagnetic effect is and the experimental search for that. And in the last part, I will talk about the latest result from the so-called Isobar collision experiment. So the concept of chirality is closely associated with a very fundamental degree of freedom of our physical particle, namely the spin. We know, for example, quarks, like electrons, they are all what we call the fermion. In the standard model of particle physics, you have six lepton and six quarks. Except neutrinos, all the others are basically Dirac fermions, okay? Dirac fermion in the massless limits become even more interesting because in that limit, your mass term dropped out from Lagrangian and you have well-defined chirality. So what is chirality? It's like your left hand and right hand is a property that basically says that your mirror image in the, you know, is not yourself. Like left hand mirror is not left hand, is a right hand, you know, in that sense. For massless particle, you have right hand and left hand particle. For the right-handed particle, your spin and momentum basically become correlated in the same direction. Or for left-handed particle, they're opposite. So that's a very intuitive way to understand what happened. This also leads to what we call the axisymmetry, which is a classical conserved, which leads to another a classical conserved axial current. In short, it's a specific correlation between spin and momentum. If you add a mass term, of course, that immediately spoils all of this chirality because it mixes up the left with the right, as you can see from this very simple term. And that also breaks the classical axial current conservation. You can see this partial mu j mu 5 has a broken term, which is proportional to the mass that you put in. Now, we, of course, are mostly focusing on the QCD. In QCD, we have the quarks and the fermion, okay? Quarks have their constituent mass in the vacuum condition. They're kind of heavy because not only that, they have a standard model mass, which is light, for example, for U quark and D quark, this is only a few MeV, but they also suffer from the so-called chiral condensate from the spontaneous symmetry breaking, okay? So they're basically very heavy, you know. You would, you know, see the kind of chiral property of load U and D light quark only upon the chiral restoration when this term really disappear. And that indeed could happen in the quark-gluon plasma, okay? So in the quark-gluon plasma, the good thing is that if you do have quark-gluon plasma and a chiral symmetry restoration, this term is gone, and you only have a very minor correction from the standard model mass, which you can pretty much ignore for the U quark and D quark. Now, in that case, the quantum theory actually gives you something even more interesting. Namely, your classical axial symmetry is still broken, even with zero mass. And that's because of what we call the quantum anomaly. Basically, your partial mu j mu 5, if you compute that to the one loop level, you get this specific breaking term. That E dot B, this is the famous chiral anomaly. Okay, I'm not going to explain that further. Just saying that this is really a very fundamental aspect of quantum field theory and our particle physics. Okay, the anomaly basically is a quantum intrinsic quantum effect. It could be understood from the so-called. This is just a very intuitive way to understand what happened. If you imagine that you have applied a strong magnetic field, okay, and your fermion. Which are charged will feel that magnetic field. Because this E dot B structure is very specific. That's why I want to explain a little bit. Now, if you put a fermion, charged fermion in the magnetic field, they form the so-called lowest the lambda level. The lowest lambda level is the most interesting one. In that case, your lambda level actually has only a right-handed branch and left-handed branch, okay? Instead of being symmetric between positive momentum and negative momentum. And we will further apply an electric field to that system in parallel to the magnetic field. It starts to pump the right-handed particle from negative infinity all the way up, where it starts to sort of push the left-handed fermion into the Dirac C. In doing so, you keep the total electric charge conserved. Okay, for every right-handed particle move up, you move one left-handed particle down. But in doing that, you create an imbalance between right-handed particle and left-handed particle. Okay, so that's why this axial charge is created by the E dot B. Our basic interest into that set is to study the many body system of quark gluon, what means like the quantum chromal matter. So the natural question is that for this kind of microscopic symmetry feature, like anomaly, what is the implication for the macroscopic property of the matter that we create, like the quark gluon plasma? That's what we want to explore. The answer is quite interesting and remarkable. And that's the chiromagnetic effect, which is basically the main topic here. It said, what is the chiromagnetic effect? It said that for a chiral system, okay, when there is a non-zero chiralitic imbalance in your system, meaning that your system had, let's say, more right-handed particle than left-handed particle, or more left-handed particle than right-handed particle. Basically, it said the chiral material is like, its mirror image is not itself, again, like your left and right hand. Now in such a system, if you apply a magnetic field, that can induce a electric current, conducting current. Now this is very, very different from our usual electromagnetism where you apply an electric field and get a conducting current. This is really a quantum mechanical transport and it's a reflection of the chiral anomaly at the macroscopic level, okay? Here is an intuitive picture to understand what happens in something like the chiromagnetic effect. If you think about this system that I just mentioned, a system of chiral fermion, you apply a magnetic field that will basically polarize the spin. Let's say for simplicity, consider them to be all positive charge. The spin will be more aligned or parallel to the magnetic field. Now, if in addition you have an imbalance of chirality, meaning that you have more right-handed particles than left-handed particles. Remember that I just mentioned that for what that means for right-handed particle. It means the spin and the momentum are correlated, which means the momentum will be aligned with spin. Now, because of that, your momentum aligned with spin and spin aligned with the magnetic field. So your charged particles have their momentum to be preferably along the magnetic field. And that is nothing but a current, okay? The same argument is true for particles that are negatively charged. Actually, the negative charged particle will move down, but they have they contribute to the electric current also going up. Okay, so in short, so that's basically an intuitive picture of what happened. It's like a magnetic polarization of spin, multiplying a chiralitic polarization of momentum, and you get a transport current along a magnetic field. But that doesn't fix this coefficient. You can see this coefficient is very, very specific. In fact, this comes directly from the chiral anomaly. If you remember the picture of the noise lambda level that I just mentioned, and indeed from that picture, you can quickly understand why that coefficient would be exactly the same as your anomaly coefficient. So basically what happens that when you start to fill up, let's say forget about temperature. If you're considering just fermion with chemical potential, if you do have, if you have equal number of right-handed particle and left-handed particle, you're filling up your state up to some energy level here. This is your chemical potential. If they're equal, you'll see nothing because right-handed particle moves to the right, left-handed particle moves to the left, they cancel out. But if you do get an imbalance between them, okay, say you have right-handed particle chemical potential to be greater than the left-handed particle, meaning you have more right-handed particle because you can fill up to this level, or the left-hand part are filling up only to here. So you see, you get actual right-handed particle. And right-handed particles are moving to the right. So you have a current along the magnetic field. And if you count precisely how many more right-handed particles you have, you get precisely the coefficient, okay? Which comes from the lambda level density of state, okay? So in short, this is really a macroscopic effect of chiral anomaly. And that's something that's really interesting. We want to find that kind of effect. There are also other reasons why we are very interested in this effect. That had to do with another important aspect of QCD, named the topology or topological non-trivial gluon field. In QCD, which is the non-abelian gauge theory, there are all these topological fluctuations in the system. What are they? Well, in a very, very simple way, what you can say that their configuration, field configuration, that are tracing the color or orientation of the gluon around the space-time boundary. Okay, it's like a Mobius stripe. Okay, that's perhaps the best illustration of something like this. These are what we call the instant on the spectrum. They are topologically non-trivial because you're wrapping your color orientation over a space-time boundary. Okay, you can use something we call a topological chart (TOW) to quantify that kind of winding. And if you look it more closely into that, of course, it's an integral of your gluon field configuration. You can see certain particular gluon field will have non-zero, topological number. And that basically goes like E dot B, if you look into the detail of that, the quantum Chrome E dot B, color inactivated color magnetic field. Now, these are P and CP odd features of your gluon field. Not only that, if you look more closely, it turns out that that gluon topology is directly connected with the quark chirality. And that's really remarkable. Actually, it has a very deep mathematical connection, which is called the Atiyah-Singer index theorem. That was, of course, extremely famous. That's a very general statement, much more general than what I just said. Something we call a lattice index, which is basically like the Dirac equation, zero mode of Dirac's operator on that certain non-trivial background field. And topology index is the topological quantum winding number of that background field. So basically that in our context, this Atiyah-Singer index theorem is exactly this formula that I write here. It says that for every unit of topological charge from this kind of gluon topological fluctuation, you create a non-zero chirality imbalance, namely the difference between right and left. You may wonder how that happened. I think this picture provides an intuitive kind of understanding of what happened. Consider note this end is like our quark. Okay, if the end is on this side of the stripe, it's called a right-handed or left-handed. On the other stripe, it's called right-handed. Now you can see if this stripe is like trivially glued together, the end will always move on the same side of the stripe. However, if you make it non-trivial, topological non-trivial by treating it before glue it together, then the end actually when you move along the strap, it will automatically go from the one side to the other side. And that's basically what happened here. So to put it short, the chirality of your quark actually tell you something about the gluon topology. And that's why it's really interesting. And also as I mentioned, to really probe the quark chirality, you need a chiral restoration. So if you are able to do that, that's also an indication of chiral restoration. So basically we want to see this net chirality or chirality fluctuation in the quark gluon plasma created by heavy ion collision. By doing that, we learn something about the gluon topological fluctuation, we learn something about chiral restoration, which are all fundamental physics. Okay. There's also an interesting cosmic connection for why we are spending so much effort to look for this chiral magnetic effect. In the cosmology, we know that there is a big puzzle, and that's the baryon asymmetry or matter-antimatter asymmetry. Today, we see overwhelmingly more and more protons than antiprotons in our universe. The question is why? If you start with the Big Bang, create everything out of pure energy, you always create a particle and antiparticle in pair. And naively, you would say you should have equal amount of proton and antiproton. And that's not the case. We're far off from that. The question is why? One of the possibilities that you can create P and CP odd domains by topological spectrum, not for the QCD, but for the inactive weak theory. And that coupled with the rapid expansion of the universe can actually give you something like this. Well, but Big Bang like a one-shot event, you don't get a chance to redo that. On the contrary, the heavy ion collision, you can do it many times. And you provide a laboratory environment where you can actually explore that mechanism. Namely, what happened in our case is that gluon topological fluctuation, just like the spheron transition in the early universe, it creates some asymmetry, not the baryon asymmetry, but the chiral asymmetry. Namely, as I just said, this topological transition here creates chiral asymmetry, namely the difference between right and left. It's like the cosmic case where a asymmetry in the matter-antimatter is created by a spheron in the electric weak theory. So really, this is a great opportunity for us to explore that physics. And that, of course, is one of the biggest questions that we have, namely, like, why we are here. You know, if our universe is not matter-dominated, we cannot exist. There are many also other examples of chiral transport phenomena, which I don't have time to discuss. For example, there's something we call chiral separation effect, chiral electric separation effect, chiral vertical effect, chiral magnetic vertical waves, and chiral plasma instabilities, and many other things. So I will just focus on one example, and that's chiral magnetic effect that I already introduced. Let me briefly mention that there are also a very strong interdisciplinary interest, for example, in the condensed matter physics. CME, that particular transport effect was observed in the so-called Dirac and Weyl semimetal. There are a lot of discussion on its possible astrophysics application for the leptons in the supernova or compact star environment. It's also relevant to cosmology, plasma physics, quantum information, and generally quantum field theory and many body theory, like the new playground for understanding chiral transport theory, chiral hydrodynamics, and so on. I won't have time to discuss this. I've introduced you to many of those recent review articles where many of these aspects are covered. Let me, of course, mention in particular that you can see that there are quite a few from nuclear science and technique, which are now widely read and cited very useful articles on this topic. Okay, so now let me come to the search for CME. I hope by now you have a good idea of what is CME and why it's so interesting to us. Okay, so now we want to look for this effect in quark-gluon plasma. This paper by Dimakajev was really kind of the starting point, it's really the starting point of the modern CME effort. He basically made an argument like exactly what I already said. The gluon topology transition provides parity violating domain, and that can induce observable effect, something like the CME. Okay, these two subsequent papers of Dima and collaborators basically laid a kind of theoretical foundation, like how to theoretically understand the chiral magnetic effect and derive the chiral magnetic effect. I think this formulated the CME as we know it today. And this paper discussing in very detail how to look for this effect and estimate, made perhaps the first estimate of the possible observable effect. On the experimental side, Sergei Voloshin at about the same time, 2004, proposed a way or the first observable to try to detect that, that effect. So how to detect that? And how do we know that something like the CME can happen? Well, that means that we need to examine the condition for that to happen. I already mentioned that, of course, the CME require a chirality imbalance, and that's available in the quark-gluon plasma through the gluon topological fluctuation. But we also need a magnetic field to induce that effect. And ideally, the stronger the magnetic field is, the better a chance we have to see that effect. Fortunately, we do have a strong magnetic field in the heavy ion collision. So this is a three-dimensional cartoon of what happened in the collision. You have two nuclei that overlap in the middle. So this is where we'll create that for gluon plasma. It's very hot. And then in addition, those moving ions, they have positively charged protons in them, and they're moving almost like a speed of light. If you do your basic electromagnetism calculation, you will realize that there is indeed a strong magnetic field pointing in the direction of the Y, which is what we call the out-plane direction, meaning that it is perpendicular to this reaction plane. Okay. This is a more detailed event by event simulation result for the average magnetic field over like several thousand events. You can see they are really strong. So this is where the quark-gluon plasma is, and they are relatively homogeneous and pointing upward, namely in the Y direction. They're strong in like 10 to 15 Tesla, which is certainly the strongest magnetic field we know. Okay. And if you convert that into the hadronic scale, it's about a few times M pi squared. So indeed, it's strong enough to induce something that we can detect. Now, what could be the signal? The signal is the following. You have the magnetic field, right, along the Y, and you have some chiral imbalance from your gluon topological fluctuation, then that B field will induce a current in the coordinate space in your plasma. And that current will transport positive charge in one direction, negative charge in the other direction. Now, as a result, in the spatial configuration, you have a little extra positive charge on one tip of your fireball, and a few extra negative charge on the other side of the fireball. And in the end, of course, the whole fireball is exploding out. It's like when you're pumping a balloon, you over pump it, it pops, right? So everything pops out and everything moves pretty much revealed. That's something we call radial flow expansion. And that radial flow basically converts that position into momentum. Well, that means that the two extra charges will move upward, or those two negative charges will move downward. So in the end, what you can detect is the dipole separation in the momentum space. Remember, our detector only detects the momentum and identity of the final particle. So basically, the charge separation effect in the final state momentum space that you can detect. Basically, you count the particle distribution in your momentum, so you see how many are positive. In the positive py, how many are negative, in the py, you make a difference, you can figure that out. However, that came with a caveat, because your mu 5 or the kinetic imbalance fluctuates from event to event, because it comes from topological fluctuation. It can be positive in one event, negative in another event. If you simply average over many events, you get nothing. So that makes it kind of difficult. Indeed, that makes all the difficulty, okay? So you cannot directly count that dipole, because the dipole flip from event to event. All you can do is look for that fluctuation, namely the dipole fluctuation. That can be measured through charged particle correlation. Namely, you can look for a specific emission pattern with charged particle correlation along the B field. You can see that in this configuration, positive charges are preferably on the near side, or positive negative charges are preferably back-to-back configuration. So these are charged particle correlation. They are charge dependent. And you can look for that. Namely, the difference in the same sign hadron and opposite sign hadron angular correlation, okay? And there's a specific direction for that effect, and that's along the Y or B direction. Okay, so that has been measured. The way to measure it is to use a more quantitative way to look for this so-called gamma correlator, which now become famous. Many people know that. So what is the gamma correlator? It's basically looking for that fluctuation that I mentioned in the B field direction, which is this sign. And you use the other direction where you don't expect anything as the kind of baseline. You do a subtraction between this direction and that direction. If there's something indeed happening in this direction, you would see that difference between the two. Okay, so that's the idea. You're looking for that difference between in-plane and out-plane. Because we have a system, we create a system hadron, final hadron on the order of a few thousand particles. You always have fluctuation. Even without any effect, you would have some dipole fluctuation, in-plane and out-plane. That's why it's actually useful to make a subtraction. You don't subtract out anything that is just simple trivial fluctuation. So again, that's the idea. So if you do have a CME, say for the same sign, you expect something like minus A1 squared, which is this, A1 is this dipole charge separation effect, or for the opposite sign, the plus A squared. Now, this was the initial 2009 result from STAR, where indeed you start to see that kind of effect. The data could be in line with CME, because you clearly see a difference between opposite sign and same sign. And that difference seems to be what you would expect from that that kind of pattern. But that also received immediate skepticism, in particular from a few groups like Fuchang Wang. They pointed out that resonance decay can mess this up, because indeed, if you're looking for the difference between them, there are other things that can cause a difference between the two terms. Resonance decay is one of them. When you have resonance decay, like row turning into pi plus pi minus, you create an angular correlation between that pi plus pi minus. And that effect is not the same in this direction, in the other direction, due to the what we call the elliptic flow. Similarly, there could also be something that we call the local charge conservation, meaning that on your fireball freeze out, there are short range correlation between the production of positive and negative charge particle. It's similar to the resonance decay. In short, the effect that mess things up is really that you have some kind of cluster from some source like a resonance or a charge neutral patch that goes in a direction that are aligned. So that creates an angular correlation between the two dot particles that are produced from the source. This effect is stronger in plane than out plane, and that effect basically scales like a V2 over N, where the V2 is the elliptic flow and N is the charge multiplicity, okay? For both effects, that's the rough pattern. I perhaps will skip this technical discussion, but just want to say that, we also, a number of us pointed out that the dominant pattern of the charge distribution from this data really means that you are seeing more of this. The magnetic field direction is here, but you're seeing the plus plus going opposite way, and that is a strong effect in the in-plane rather than out-plane. And that's due to the transverse momentum conservation. So again, apparently a lot of things are going into that. So we were really facing a setback at that time prompted people to redefine the question. Namely, is there anything remaining? It was clear by that point that all these measurements, charge correlation, gamma, same sign, off sign, they're dominated by background. The question is there anything remaining? What fraction of that gamma correlator could still be from CME? But I should say that it's certainly not time to give up, because if you think about all those difficult searches that have been going on for years and years and years, the latest example, right, the gravitational wave, it started in like 1960, 1970. And we were able to detect the first gravitational wave only after something like 60 years. So it's a hunt of a needle in a haystack. So not gonna be easy, but we're not gonna give up. A lot of effort were put to fight the background, okay? Like try to develop models to separate the background and the signal. For example, one of the possibilities to use the so-called H correlator, you try to separate the flow background dependent part in the gamma from a true CME signal. And that can be separated by using another correlation that we measure, the so-called delta correlator. If you do that, you do see some non-zero remnants that could be the signal. Okay, so this is anonymous probably by star. Oh, first, that was maybe not the most mature measurement, but at that time it was important to see that there could be a signal that still are in there. Okay. We also started to think about other possible ways to manifest the current magnetic effect. One of the possibilities is the so-called current magnetic wave. So it's like our electromagnetic wave, where electric field induces magnetic field and magnetic field induces electric field, and then they propagate together. In the case of a chiral material, if you have a magnetic field and you have axial charge and a vector charge in your system, and their fluctuation will also be coupled together through the chiral magnetic effect and a chiral separating effect. As a result of that, they can propagate together through mutually inducing the fluctuation, just like the electromagnetic wave. And a wave equation was derived, and from that you can say that if you do have a magnetic field, you can induce some specific propagating mode, the chiral magnetic wave, in your quark-gluon plasma. And the consequence that were proposed in a 2011 paper is that it can cause a charge-dipole separation between negative and positive charge, okay? Because no negative charge and positive charge will move differently because of the wave, okay? That prediction seemed to be seen from experimental analysis by Star and also Alice. This is the beam energy dependent extraction of that particular parameter that asymmetry between the V2 minus and V2 plus. Okay. Well, this just to tell you that there are different ways of manifesting CME, and we seem to see some encouraging hints. Around 2015, we published a status report, summarized the situation. And that time, CME was also found in the semimetal, which gave us even more urgency to look for this effect in our system. I gave a talk at Quark Matter 15 and tried to convey the message that it's not time to give up yet, and we do have some hope. And around that time, in the US, we also formed the beam energy scan theory collaboration that committed to invest efforts to figure out the theoretical description of the CME in the heavy ion collision. And on the experimental side, there's the Isobar task force that was formed around that time to explore a possible new experiment to have a kind of a decisive test of the CME. And since then, actually there were a lot of strong experimental activities that were going on. Many new analyses were done, for PA, DA, kappa, kappa, gold, all these different systems from energy down to about 10 GeV, all the way up to, 5,000 GeV, star, Ali, CMS. They all made interesting efforts, develop a new method like event shape engineering or using the event plane versus the reaction plane method. So this actually relies on a feature that we found together with Xu Guang a while ago, namely the magnetic field actually had a mutual angle fluctuation And because of that, your magnetic field correlates better with the reaction plane and correlates worse with the event plane. And that feature can be used to help separate the background and the signal. That was proposed by Fu Chang and a collaborator, and also Sergei. Many other observables were proposed, like using event mask and this extraction of signal where event plane reaction I already mentioned. And also Ai-Hong proposed the signed balance function, Relase proposed R correlator. All these different observers are trying to look for the signal parts that are free or in some way can be separated from the background contamination. Okay, they had varied degree of success. I think it's fair to say that we do see some good hint of signal. Okay. Well, maybe even a very positive hint. So this was the star compilation at Quark Matter 19. I'm hoping that in a few weeks with the Quark Matter 2022, we'll see a new compilation, hopefully, from star. So certainly there is a very positive hint that there, namely within the gamma correlator, you have a non-zero fraction of the CME signal. But this is the inconclusive because there are large statistical and systematic error bar that you cannot make a really like strong statement about it. This is another compilation that we made with Dima when we were writing this article last year or 2 years ago. So you can see again, so it, there is certainly a very good hint of signal, but it's not conclusive. As I mentioned, we form a theoretical collaboration that's called the BAS collaboration. So one important phase component of that BAS collaboration is to build a theoretical tool for the quantitative prediction of CME, because now it becomes a subtle question. You're looking for a small signal out of a large background. So you have to make your theoretical prediction more precise. You want to understand the background, you want to understand, signal in the environment of heavy ion collision. So that's essentially what we built in the last several years. We had a few papers published, and also very recently there is the BAS collaboration publication in this paper. If you're interested, I encourage you to take a look. Basically, this is what we call the event by event anomalous viscous fluid dynamics, AVFD. So that is shows different modules that go into this. You can see it's a very state of the art modeling of a heavy ion collision process, starting from event by event initial condition with both the bulk matter and the electromagnetic field. You have hydrodynamic evolution, then you use the so-called anomalous hydrodynamics to describe the chiral transport, which is where the CME is. And then you do the you freeze out in here, you implement important background effect like a no charge conservation. And then you have a real hadron cascade process through the URQMD. So everything pretty much are included, okay? So this is showing you some example. So this is the actual equation, that just for those who are curious about it, the CME goes into the evolution of those right-hand and left-handed quark current. This is where they show up, and they are sensitive to the magnetic field. They're sensitive to the chirality because it's positive for the right-handed, negative for the left-handed. And if you do really run a simulation from some initial condition, you can see this is an example. You suppose the magnetic field in the y direction. You start with the same initial profile for the right-handed and left-handed particles, like U quark. You end up with a tilted picture for right-handed, like more right-handed particle move up, more left-handed particle move down. Now you can imagine that if you have a non-zero chirality, meaning one is more than the other, you will have up-down asymmetry. Okay, so chirality imbalance needs our right-left asymmetry, which needs a charge asymmetry on your fireball as a freeze-out. And this is basically the hydrodynamic realization of CME in heavy ion collision. It's a very precise description. Remember that, when I actually introduced that charge 17 picture, we were using a kind of particle picture, which were more like hand-waving argument. But this is a very precise way of telling what happened with this CME transport. So we apply that to the gold-gold collision. For example, we computed a signal, which seemed to be quite in line with the extraction at the time from star. Perhaps this tool has now been, it was shared actually with star collaboration and Ali's collaboration also a few years ago, and that has now become a widely used tool for developing semi-observable, calibrating sensitivity to signal and background, as well as obtaining quantitative understanding of data. recently we even published a paper. I'm proud that I published a paper with our star friend together and with my former student Shu Dexu, using this tool to basically provide the kind of the theoretical foundation for those analysis of experimental observables, which are very useful for the isobar analysis. I want to mention that my former student Shu Dexu is a very energetic young man who had basically played the key role in developing this whole formalism and this simulation, which now been very, very useful. And he's a very, very, I think, very promising young man. I hope our senior colleagues pay attention to his name. So there are also many transport studies, transport model study of CME. I think, for example, you can use the AMPT-based model to figure out the possible signal and background response. So that's been done by our friend here at the Fudan group, like Guo Liang, Yu Gang, Xu Guang, and so on. There's also chirokinetic transport approach by Chen Mingko and his student and collaborators. So these are some of the relevant references. So finally, I think I have a few minutes that bring me to the last thing I want to say, and that's about the isobar collision. As I mentioned, a task force was formulated to study what you can achieve by doing an isobar collision experiment. That was around 2015-16. So these are some of the people that were involved in that task force. So we managed to get this report actually published with the Chinese Physics C in 2016. So basically the initial idea was from Voloshin. I think he mentioned that this could be a possibility. So the basic idea is the following. You try to do collision with two different nuclear systems that are isobars, like the ruthenium and zirconium. They have the same number of nuclei, like 96 for each, but the ruthenium had more protons, 44 protons, where the zirconium had only 40. What that means is that you should create, in this kind of collision, the collisions are dominated by QCD effect. So it doesn't care too much about that difference between proton and neutron in terms of the negative charge. So you would expect that the two collision systems will create pretty much identical fireball, the quark-gluon plasma. But ruthenium would have some extra proton that give you a stronger magnetic field. So CME is sensitive to that magnetic field, or the bulk property should not be sensitive to that. Okay, so that's the idea. You want to make a contrast. And indeed, that idea seemed to be verified by many simulations, model calculations, and so on. This is a simple way to, kind of visualize what I just said. Ruthenium, suppose you measure gamma correlation for CME, there's a big background for ruthenium, and there's some signal for ruthenium. You do the same for the zirconium, there should be also a background and signal. But the idea that if the background between the two are identical, you make a ratio, you make a subtraction, you would be able to access pure signal. So that's the whole idea. And the signal is driven by magnetic field, as I just said. Background is driven by something we call the collective flow, the elliptic flow, which is basically this shape, geometric shape. And you can see that simulation indeed suggests that there's a big difference. The two systems differ in magnetic field square by about 15%, or almost identical in their geometry. So there is a potential of discovery through isobar collision. The isobar collision run was done in 2018, and then the star collaboration was very serious about this effort. They decided to do the so-called blind analysis, which means that you don't know what you're analyzing for the analysis group, and you do whatever you want to do with it, and then in the end, you will be told which one is ruthenium and which is in the corner. A very, very naive way of seeing what's going on. But it's really a very rigorous procedure that being identified, actually started published in a paper on that blind analysis procedure, which actually was published in the Nuclear Science and Technique. So to cut a long story short, 3 years after the experiment in the 2021 September, the result was released. That's the star paper. The summary plot is this guy. Sorry, I'm running a little bit late, but I think I just have a few more slides. So these are all different analysis method with different observable, different groups and so on. You can see they're around, they're quite consistent in somewhere in this ratio, the ruthenium over zirconium ratio somewhere around here. Now this dashed line is what people call the predefined criteria baseline, predefined baseline. It say that if there are nothing, if in a null scenario with only background, you should have one, okay? If you have signal, you should actually expect this ratio to be greater than one. Now you look at this, you know, it doesn't make sense at all because it's not on the baseline, it's not above the baseline, it's actually below the baseline, okay? That surprised everybody, I guess. But, you know, indeed, people quickly, I mean, our star colleague, they quickly, of course, realized that there are some trouble. Namely, if you look more carefully into the bulk property of the two systems, the two isobar system, for the same centrality, their Lambert particle, namely multiplicity and the elliptic flow are not identical. If you take a ratio of the elliptic flow and multiplicity of the two systems, so this is the plot for the V2 ratio, this is the plot for the multiplicity ratio, they consider show a few percent of difference, okay, between the isobar. In other words, our assumption about the identical bulk matter in the two systems is too naive. It's wrong, basically. So in that, but on the other hand, STAR did this blind analysis, which means they couldn't change anything in what they planned, okay? At least that's what we were told. So the conclusion said that significant differences in the multiplicity and flow harmonics are observed between the two systems in a given centrality, indicating that the magnitude of the same background is different between the two species. That's a very clear statement. In the end, it said that no semi signature that satisfies the predefined criteria has been observed in isobar collision in this blind analysis. I think these are all very, very precise statements, but a kind of an indirect statement. My more direct statement would be like the predefined criteria is wrong. No real conclusion could be made yet about signal. So that's essentially what it says, okay? But on the other hand, STAR in the same paper actually also published or included something that's really helpful, meaning that namely that, you know, there's this post-blind analysis where they put an additional point here, you know, along with all the other measurement ratio. So this is the ratio between the ruthenium and zirconium of their 1/n factor. Okay, why does that matter? If you recall, when I was mentioning those major backgrounds, the resonance decay, the local charge conservation, I said they scale like 1/n. N is like charge multiplicity. Okay. In other words, if the two systems they have different, they produce different number of particles. One produces 1,000, the other produces 1,005 or 1,010. Of course, they're different. And the isobar analysis has a remarkable precision. Okay, so you cannot ignore that few percent of difference. If you take that into account, you would say, okay, this 1/n maybe provide a much more sensible baseline. In other words, your baseline is not this naive predefined baseline at one. It's more this baseline at about 0.94 or sorry 0.96. If you take that your lazy man baseline, you will see all the signals, all the measurements are standing above the baseline. But that means that they are consistent with CME signal. Well, again, so this is certainly not a conclusion yet. I think that's just an important information that I hope everybody know. And I want to say that this is actually a pretty positive hint because all these points, they have fairly small error bars thanks to the large data set of the isobar and a very dedicated analysis with high precision. So they're having a pretty significant, like of maybe even a couple of sigma significant above this mark. Okay. Okay. There were actually maybe I'll skip this. Just want to mention that there are also this reaction versus event plane method actually show pretty clear and positive, indication of signal both in the isobar at a few percent level and in this gold latest gold analysis. They even show something like 2 to 3 sigma of CME signal in the gold by using this contrast between the reaction plane and the event plane. Well, you may wonder, for such a big experiment, big investment, didn't nobody thought about it before? Well, actually people did think about it, okay? Actually back in 2018, a few groups already started to warn about this issue, because the key for the success is that you are assuming identical bulk between the ruthenium and zirconium. And there were worries from us and from Haojie and Fu Qiang and the collaborators, and also from other people. We clearly, not only that we worry about it, we actually showed that, you know, your isobar contrast would sensitively depend on the initial nuclear geometry of your collision. If you use different initial conditions for your nucleon distribution at the beginning of the collision, you can have as large as a few percent of difference in elliptic flow. Okay, this was from my 2018 quark matter proceeding. It was clearly said at quark matter, and was clearly written down in that proceeding. But we also, not only that we realized this issue, we actually even provided a strategy to overcome this issue. Namely, you can actually apply a joint multiplicity and elliptic flow cut for the event sample. If you do that, you can immediately reduce the bulk difference down to below percent level, where your magnetic field still remain at 15-20% of the difference level. So that could be a way out if your isobar system are not perfectly identical. Indeed, we published a paper before the isobar results in which we made quantitative prediction of semi-signal with proper suppression of that kind of background difference. We took that into account in our paper. So these are the predictions about the delta gamma and delta, even delta, between the two systems. We have very specific prediction for what we would expect if the background difference is suppressed. Okay, so hopefully some new analysis would show that kind of behavior. But on the other hand, let me say that one person's trouble may be another person's opportunity, okay? Many people actually realize that, with a very high precision measurement in the isobar, they can even help us to nail down some of the uncertainty in the nuclear geometry. That's a kind of very fascinating possibility. Recently, people like Jiang Yong and, his postdoc, Fu Qiang and Guo Liang, Hui Cao and others, they started to explore those possibilities, namely, how you understand this, difference in the V2 and the multiplicity between the two systems, what that can, tell us about the initial nuclear geometry of those two systems. I think that's a really remarkable example for connecting the low energy nuclear structure physics with high energy heavy ion physics, okay? There was a workshop back in January. If you're interested in that, you could go to that workshop website and see more information. So that brings me to the summary. I hope that I conveyed to you that the physics of CME is rich and fundamental. The search for CME in heavy ion collision is of great importance, yet challenging. Existing data show positive hints of signals, but are inconclusive due to the strong background. Isobar collision collect a high precision data set with potential for finding CME. Okay, that's what all I would say at this point, okay? And again, I reiterate that why this is really interesting. With a very precise experimental determination of that CME correlation, you are able to access this axial charge or chiral imbalance, which in turn have access to gluon topology. That's why we're really interested in that. So recently in a paper, we showed how you can make this connection quantitative with our theoretical tool. So eventually, if the experiment can tell us the number of the CME fraction of the gamma, we can quickly use that to tell you how many gluon topological fluctuations you expect for the first time, okay? So what's next? Well, the near-term focus of the theoretical effort would be nailing down the correct baseline and obtaining a precise understanding of isobar bulk properties that I already mentioned. What we're doing that we're using the EB AVFD, and we're trying to use well-informed nuclear structure inputs, and we use the measured bulk property data to calibrate our calculation. And then with that, hopefully we can establish a quantitative baseline. And from there, we can further examine the response by adding CME signals. So in other words, we can start with the pure background calculation to establish a baseline, and then we add CME signals, see the response, and then we compare with experimental data to quantify signal level in a statistically meaningful way. On the experimental side, I think the Isobar post-blind analysis are ongoing, and we are very, very much anticipating new results to come out. Beyond just the blind analysis. And we also heard that the new analysis strategy for Isobar being tried, for example, using the multiplicity cut as we suggested, even shape analysis and so on. And finally, I think some experimenters emphasize, especially for Chang, I think high precision gold-gold analysis perhaps makes sense because indeed, Isobar and gold-gold have their different strengths. The opportunity of provided by Isobar is that you can compare two systems if you are able to make their background to be identical. Okay, so that's really helpful. The gold-gold had the advantage that its signal is probably larger than that in the Isobar, emphasized by Fuchang and other people. So the hope is that if you have something like the precision of Isobar for the gold-gold analysis, you could perhaps improve the 2 to 3 sigma level of finding to a 5 sigma level. Okay, so that's of course quite exciting as well. So I think it's really an exciting time over the next couple of years. I would encourage you to stay tuned. So I'll stop here. Thank you very much for your attention.
好，谢谢这个金峰非常精彩的报告啊。这个金峰这个开头讲的非常简略了，然后就到最后就是主要是讲我们现在这个中离子膨胀的一些这个新的进展跟面临的一些这个发展的机遇。那么大家看看对他这个报告啊有什么这个需要提问的或者需要讨论的，请大家提出来。大家可以举手啊。哦，徐光吧，我看到徐光了。
啊，好的。啊，金峰，非常精彩的报告。我有一个问题啊，你能这稍微再展开一下关于 Isobar， 你刚才说的有一个可以通过做这个 joint cut， for 这个 V2 和这个多重数来这个降低由于这个两个系统的背景的差异造成的这个区别，对，就这个图，对，这个能讲一下这个原因吗？或者怎么通过这种办法来降低这个分析里的这种差异。
对，我们当时这也就意识到这个问题之后呢，我们就在进行一些就是计算，看之后怎么能够克服这样一个问题。那么我们就发现，就是说，比如说你按照传统的，比如说你 run the ruthenium 和 zirconium， 对吧？每个 run 一个 million 的 event， 然后呢，你按照他们传统的这个叫做这个 centrality 的办法做了之后，比如说你在20到30 centrality， 你把这些 event sample 拿来比较呢，就看到 v2 有 difference， 对不对？那么
对
比如说在这个里面有 10% 的 event， 对吧？就比如说 0.1 million 的 event， 那么你把这些 event 呢，你把他们俩同时出一个一模一样的 cut， 就比如说是就是说 multiplicity 都在某一个范围内，然后呢 eccentricity 也都在同一个范围内，那么这样的话呢，你把这些就这相当于是说你这个 centrality 里面这些 event 的一个 sub event， 当然我不希望 cut 太多，我们只 cut 就，但是重点是说这两个系统用同样的 cut， 相当于他们 differ 的，就是相当于是说在这个distribution 的尾巴上的一些东西呢，我们就把它丢掉了，对吧？你 apply 一样的 cut 之后呢，再来比较这两个系统。
啊，就是在 event 里面再取一些 sub event， 使得在这个 sub event 里。
对，你可以说，对。
constraint
你比如说我的20到30，我把这些所有的 event 拿来之后，我通过 apply 这个 cut 呢，我大概只用了，比如说每个系统都只用了70%的 event， 但是呢，我再把它取出来之后，我可以直接比较，就是可以 verify 他们的 v2 啊，那个 multiplicity 都是一样的。
嗯，对对对 ，I see， 好，谢谢，
好，万总，王老师，
金峰 ，Yeah，nice talk， so
thank you，
yeah， what you said about the isobar system， I think it's not really that we cannot draw any conclusion or something， and I think it is clear from theIsobar result, because that if there is a CME signal in isobar, it got to be small, right? So that is a quite interesting conclusion. So and that if you know, no matter what you do, I think probably the upper limit on the CME for in the isobar system, you know, probably 90% confidence level, should be below maybe 5% or so. Okay, so the real question here is that given the isobar system, the CME constraint is constrained to be rather small. Okay, so the question is whether that same constraint, when extrapolated to gold on gold collisions, okay, that would be in contradiction to what we think happened in gold on gold collision, whether that is also provide a really strong constraint on gold on gold collisions. Okay. And that part we found that the extrapolation is questionable. This is because from isobar system to gold on gold collisions, that the magnetic field is differed by factor of 2. So therefore the CME effect may be differed by factor 4. Then also the background in the isobar system is higher than the background in gold on gold collision. Therefore, a naive extrapolation from isobar system, say an upper limit of 5%, okay, will become a 20% upper limit in gold on gold collision if you just extrapolate based on the knowledge about magnetic field and the background. Okay, so if that's the case, then 20% upper limit in gold on gold collision is not strong enough to allow us to say that there's no CME effect in gold on gold collision as what we may concluded in the past. Okay, and that's the kind of break in this reasoning from isobar to gold. And that's also one of the reasons that we needed to really focus on gold on gold collisions. In particular, we need to take advantage of the B energy scan data when they're at a somewhat lower beam energies. Okay, there's certainly the jet related correlations, okay, will be smaller. I mean, some of the interpretation try to explain the previous data gamma measurement. I mean, once you introduce a cluster effect, for example, then of course you will be able to explain this. I mean, this is because to some extent, if you allow a formation of a CP, the parity order domain, I mean, in a broad sense, it is a clustering of particles. It's just in certain ways that the charge gets separated because we cannot measure the absolute charge separation. We really measure the square of the charge separation. And in that kind of sense, then if you allow yourself to introduce some clusters, of course you can explain everything, but that doesn't help because you needed to really know what cluster you're talking about. So, I mean, that's my comment. And so I certainly welcome you to give more guidance on what we really can get from the low energy gold on gold collisions. I think for the isobar is, I think there is a conclusion to be drawn, but that conclusion can be improved by knowing the background better, by knowing the baseline better, but that won't change the conclusion significantly.
I basically, thanks Huanzhong for the very detailed comment. And I basically agree with all the points you made, except that with the conclusion for the isobar. So you are completely right that the signal in the gold-gold should be larger for several reasons. The fraction of CME in the gold-gold would be bigger. As you already mentioned, there's a bigger background magnetic field. And actually, we also developed a model to calculate axial charge, which is also bigger in the gold-gold. And also the background, which goes one over multiplicity, should be lower in principle in the gold-gold. So you're right. The signal in the gold-gold should be larger. And going for gold-gold with high precision is definitely the right thing to do, as I mentioned in the outlook. On the other hand, again, I think the advantage of isobar is that you have a sort of contrast system, and that's why you know all these are plotted as a ratio, right? I think there is, well, I'm overly optimistic. I think if we're able to, so of course, what we learned now is that the two systems are not exactly identical. There is a few percent level of difference between them. But I'm kind of optimistic if we're able to nail that down, you still can reach something like, you know, maybe even 3-4 sigma level of confidence that these points are definitely above the ratio. Okay, so I think that would be a useful conclusion, namely there is a non-zero signal, and then it comes to the quantitative question, like what you said, namely what is the fraction of that CME signal. And I agree
that's very difficult. I mean, I'm not as optimistic as you may think in terms of the isobars. This is because given what we know about the difference in the shape of these two nuclei, that it's really difficult to know the shape better than 1%. Although our measurement precision is at a percent level. Okay? Mm-hmm. So you need to know your systematics on this baseline better than 1%, which it,
correct.
You can be sure that it's really harder to achieve, even at a 1% level, that accuracy we have achieved so far, that already put a quite stringent limit on the magnitude of the CME that we up limit on this isobar systems, right? So that itself is already a significant result. Because that mm-hmm. result constrains what the magnitude of CME in the isobar systems. Okay, so the difficulty is how to extrapolate to Golden-Golden collision, and which that extrapolation certainly does not give us the maintain this really strict constraints on the Golden-Golden systems.
Right. No, you're right. But remember that gold actually is showing some signal for sure. It's not like 5 sigma, but it's certainly showing some signal. And I would agree with you that I didn't have time to emphasize this, but some analysis like what you guys did a while ago with this beam energy dependence certainly would be very, very useful. If one is able to extend analysis of the gold, from 200 GeV down to some of this region, that could certainly help a lot, because from this earlier analysis back in 2014, it certainly showed a beam energy dependence that say that the best or the most biggest signal maybe is around 62 GeV or something like that, and that would be certainly an interesting thing to pursue if some of those analysis can be done with the beam energy scan data in those regions.
Yeah, we are looking at 27 GeV and 19.6 GeV, and so that's a sweet spot, and it's
27. So that's through around here, basically.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that'd be great. I don't disagree. I mean, I agree that the gold certainly had a big signal. My only point was isobar provide a good contrast, and I think from a theoretical point of view. Well, of course, there is this difference, but it's not too difficult. So we are almost there. I think even Guo Liang tried with MPT, and Hui Chao tried with hydro, and other groups also tried with different hydro. You could, by playing a little bit with the nuclear geometry inputs, like the radius, neutron skin, your beta 2, beta 3, you can achieve a reasonably decent description of those ratios. Okay, if that is achieved, then you use the pure background calculation, like implementing your local charge conservation and the resonance decay, you could get a reasonably quantitative baseline. I agree that the isobar is not.
Yeah, but this ad hoc approach to describe the background, it's really difficult to assign a systematic error to be sub-percent. That's the difficult part.
I see what you mean.
Okay.
Okay. I don't want to take too long for this, but yeah, it's just the, you know, I think it's a nice talk, but I kind of disagree with what you say about you know, the isobar system. I think we learned a lot from isobar system, and there is a limit how much more we can learn.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Indeed, Gold could give you a bigger shot for the signal. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. 哎，王晨晨，听见吗？我看你举手了。
听到，马老师。廖老师您好，我有一个小问题，就是就是如果在一个事件里面，我们既有这个 CME， 然后又有这个 CMW， 或者甚至有 CVE， 还是那有一个粒子，它因为这个 CME 被移到极点了，然后可能又因为 CMW， 又被移到这个 in plane， 那这个就是在这个实验的角度，如果这些现象就全都存在，那么这几个现象之间，守正反常效应之间会不会影响我们实验的观测量呢？就是现在他们。会不会都作用到某一个观测量里面？比方说这个 CMW 去影响这个 gamma correlate。
这是个很好的问题。这个从理论计算的角度呢，实际上呢，这不是一个很大的问题。就是看看我那个 slide 在这里，你看啊，就是说，这个从某种意义上 ，CME 和 CMW 它们的 difference 就是说。他们需要不同的 initial condition。实际上呢，你在同一个 hydro 框架里面呢，都可以描述。换句话说，就 automatically， 不管是你是 CME 和 CMW， 他们都包括在这个流体力学的演化里面。你比如说你看啊，这个 CMW 呢，它是需要一个 vector charge 的，就看它是这个产生这个效应的呢，它是正比这个 A 是什么东西呢 ？A 就叫 charge asymmetry。就是说我这个势力里面的正负电荷的差别，对吧？这个 charge symmetry 相当于就告诉你的 initial condition 有不为零的这个 vector charge density， 就是比如就是正电荷比负电荷多，对吧？那么这个呢是可以 implement 到 hydrodynamic calculation。 你比如你如果计算这个东西的话，你如果你的初始条件如果不是说一个 kinetic imbalance， 而是一个比如说是charge imbalance， 比如说你的 u quark 比 d quark 多，那么它就会 automatic trigger 这个 CMW， 所以原则上所有这些效应都可以在流体力学计算里面是没有关系的，就是你给定初始条件，它都会自然的产生。那么对 CME 的话，它是一定是需要有一个这个我们说 kinetic 的这个 imbalance 才会产生出来，就是这样的。对，它对这个 vector charge 的 initial condition 呢，它并不敏感。这个我们也在就是计算里面，在这篇文章里面你可以去找到，就是我们专门测试了这个问题。对。
哦，好的，
对对对，
好，谢谢刘老师。
哎，没事，谢谢。好像没有声音了。
哎，廖老师，我想问一个问题。
啊，你说。
哎，你好，就是你刚刚就是提到的那个，就是现在 isobar 实验结果出来，就是基本上都是小于一的，所以说就可能需要看是不是有一个就是新的一个 baseline， 然后是不是就是说因为这个 delta gamma， 它我不知道这个 delta gamma 它受不受这个核结构的这个。就是 isobar 的这个核结构的影响，但是那个 V2 现在是基本上被认为是受这个核结构的影响。那是不是现在你比如说我们在这个模型上就是对这个 isobar 的这两种核的这个核结构有一个比较精确的这样一个认识，那我们知道就是 V2 它受的这个核结构的影响会更大一些，然后如果说这个 delta gamma 它不怎么受这个核结构的影响，那是不是就知道了这个 ratio 它确实是要比这个一要小一些，所以说我们就需要一个就是新的一个 baseline， 然后就知道如果是就是超过比如说这里的这个 0.96， 它就其实已经是发现了这个 CME 的一个信号。
对，就你说的这，我基本上同意，就是说这个差别呢，就是现在一般认为呢，是由于这个他们的核结构的，就是说这个初始条件相当于带来初始条件上的微小差别。这个呢确实也有很多计算，刚才我提到了，包括像国亮他们的这个惠超老师啊，他们都做了一些相关的计算，我们也做过一些相关的计算，就是说你比如说初始你要最简单的想法，比如说你就比如说用这个我前面提到的这个。你哪怕就用 Woods Saxon 嘛，就不用更复杂的，你就用 Woods Saxon， 你调一些就是那个出这个input parameter 的话，那么就会产生就很明显的差别，就几个 percent level 的差别是完全可以产生出来的。所以说呢，这个就是说，也就表示说呢，他们的两个人就是说这个 ruthenium zirconium 他们的我刚才提到的这个 background 这个部分呢，这个并不是 identical 的，对吧？那么你想。Ruthenium over zirconium， 我们正常情况下，如果是纯 background， 就是应该等于一，对吧？如果有 signal 呢，这个 ratio 它上面除以下面应该大于一，这是我们原来的想法。那么现在显然告诉你它不是这个样子。那么你让它这个 ratio 小于一呢，只有一种可能，就是这个 background 上面产生的东西，对不对？因为你的 signal 的话 ，Ruthenium 肯定是大于 zirconium， 所以只可能是 the background 两个的不一样，并且不一样的方式呢，是 zirconium 比 Ruthenium 要大，才能产生一个小于一的这样一个 ratio， 对吧？那么实验数据呢，关于这个 V2 和 multiplicity， 特别是 multiplicity 这个 region 呢，也确实 support 这样一个观点。那么呢，这也就是说，为什么现在大家希望说能不能把 nuclear geometry 搞清楚？然后呢，我们就说能正确的计算这些 ratio。但是呢，我告诉你，就是说这个呢也不是那么容易。当然，那个我刚才提到了有他们有江勇他们有办一个 workshop， 那么专门讨论这些问题。那么呢，确实呢，这个东西呢，nuclear structure 那一面来说呢。对这些核的性质也不是说我能够把它完全的就是说定下来，对吧？就是说它也有很多的不确定性。那么这也是为什么可能黄老师刚才就是黄忠老师刚才说这个可能很难把这东西定到 percent level 来得到一个更精确的这个结论。这个我从某种意义上也同意，就是说这个可能就是说要那么定量的，就是说来 extract signal 可能是比较困难的，就是说由于这些核结构啊，这个 bulk 这个物质的这个性质的不确定性。有很大的一些挑战。
好的，谢谢老师。
好，下面郭亮。郭亮。
哎，金峰。
哎，
那个，谢谢你这个精彩报告。那个就是你作为就是我们这个就 CME theoretical study 这个 leader 之一，我想就是问一下你的这个个人的这个 perspective， 就是对于我们这个理论的这个。方面这个 CME 的研究，就未来的这个未来的研究，尤其是对于 Isobar， 能不能详细的那个说一说？
你这个太客气，我们都大家都是一起研究这个事情嘛。反正就是说我自己的看法，就是说，其实我在这个从某种意义上，当然刚才那个焕忠老师已经说了他们从实验家的角度的一些观点，我从某种意义上那里也完全。完全是赞同的，就是说，但是呢，这样一个实验也这么这个高精度的 data， 我们当然还是希望去 try to learn more。这是为什么我说在最后我再说的，就是说，我自己觉得的话，就是说，如果说我们通过一些 modeling， 不管是说用流体力学的或者 transformer 或怎么样，那么呢，我们用一些就是说，比如说我们从 nuclear structure 对于这个isobar 这个系统有一些已知的 information。加上一些未知的呢，就像你在那个前面一月份的 workshop 上讲过一样，那些未知的部分呢，我们通过调节，那么如果说能够把这个Isobar 的这个 bulk 的实验数据能够比较好的描述，当然这个比较好呢，如果要定量，当然是一个更困难的时候，我们是不是说是在多大程度上能够描述它这个multiplicity 啊 v2 v3 的 ratio？ 但是呢，如果说我们到一定程度上能够很好的描述那些的话。那么这个呢，至少能帮助我们去 establish 一个 baseline。我觉得这个呢，相当于说我们用更 rigorous 的去那个把这个东西定下来，就相当于这个 one over n 当然是一个非常 crude 的 baseline。但是我觉得，既然我们有这么多的这个好的 data， 那么我们也有相应的理论工具，我们去把这个东西呢，如果能定下来呢，当然是非常有意义的。就是说比如说举个例子，就如果我们把 bulk 描述之后，这个线现在是 0.955、那么那当然这是一个很有意义的 number， 对吧？就是它比这个
number
要更有意义一些。
不太一样，对于不同的 observer 不一定都是这个相同的一个数，对吧？
对，这也是一个有意思的问题。我明白你说的，你要不同的计算，是不是说能够得出一个 consistent 的 baseline，
就是，
对吧？这个实际上是一个很好的 test。
嗯，是。
我刚才说了，我的意思就是，比如咱们就是不同的 group， 对吧？我们都首先第一个目标是说，我们把这些 ratio 能够合理的描述，
对
吧？对吧？有这个之后，
在这个基础上，然后去把那个 baseline 争取找出来，
对，
在理论上面，好的，嗯。
就我们现在在这方面做一些努力，对，
是的，嗯，
这个我看，嗯，对，李飞还有问题吗？啊，小邱，对，徐毅，
他可能举了手没放下，哎，李飞，不是那个，金峰你好，那个我有一个，
我刚已经问了。
很短的问题，就是你们现在理论上对这个 flavor dependence 的怎么看啊？这最近一两年有没有新的进展？这个 S 夸克这块，因为现在实验上关于这个我们测的越来越多了，所以不知道你们关于这个有没有最新的解释？
嗯，我有印象的是，Alice 有这个相关的测量结果，对具体的我稍微有点记不清了，但是我就说可以，比较 confident 的说，就是说我们发现就是 S quark 好像基本上，它的这个 anomaly transport 效应，基本上跟轻 quark 很接近。换句话说，这个 K 的话，它也会有这个 charge separation effect， 就是这至少是我印象中是这样的。我可以回头找到更定量的一些可能一些结果或者计算，可以跟你再讨论一下。但是我印象中是这样的，就是说 S quark 虽然有我们把这个100，就是比如它这个波维林的质量的影响放进去之后，好像没有看到对这个 anomaly transport 有很大的影响。对，但当然这是一个完全这个定量的问题。这个他们有一些理论的 analysis， 就是说这个东西是正比 m over t 的平方。那么这个s bar 100的 m e v 的话呢，可能它确实带来了一个比较小的修正，就是对于这个 anomaly transport。
好的，谢谢。
哎，
好。那我看啊，张松又冒出来。那松，你提个问题。
哎，金峰你好。
哎，你好。
啊，非常感谢这么丰富的这个报告，很精彩。我请教你个问题，就是刚才郭亮他们也都问过了，就是这个核结构，就是我们现在这个两个这个 Isobar 它这个核结构呢，就是有很多这个 configuration。那么你对这个的一些看法，然后就是我们通过这个就是高能这个重核碰撞，然后怎么去把它的这个 deformation 能够这些参数能不能定下来，像那个江勇他们呢也都提出来了一些这个建议，但是就是这个里边我们突破有没有办法可以突破 flow， 不用 flow 的这个办法有没有办法去观测这些参数，因为 flow 它本身就受这个出胎的这个 deformation 或者出胎的一些这个 fluctuation 的这些影响，那我们再拿这个观测量去 constrain 这个 deformation 的这些参数，这些之间的这些关联，那么它自己的这些关联怎么能够很好的去掉。
这个谢谢你这个很好的问题。这个问题说实话，我自己也没有很深入的思考。目前我们能看到的呢，就是说，因为在重力的碰撞里面的话，就是高能重力的碰撞的话说的话呢，那么核结构或者说这个核的几何，它的大小啊，它的形状形变呢，这些主要就是说影响的话呢，主要是影响在这个初始条件上 ，initial condition 上面。那么这些 initial condition 呢，在高能核碰撞它最主要的一个效应就是说它会对这个后面的 flow 产生直接的影响，所以可能我想这也是为什么现在绝大部分的人就是说在计算上来说的话，都是在就是说 focus 在这个上面，就是说比如说这些 flow 的观测量啊什么的，那么它到底对这个初始这个 input 有多大的 sensitivity。 那我觉得这个还是一个挺有意思的一个就是说这个 approach 或者这个方法，因为在毕竟来说，在高能核碰撞来说，对这个 flow 的这个行为啊和它的测量和理论计算呢，都是非常成熟的吧？你可以认为就像一个，你像做一个映射一样，一个 mapping， 对吧？你从 initial condition 到这个 final state 这个 flow observable 它们之间有一个相对来说比较well controlled 的这样一个 mapping。 那么在这样的情况下呢，那么你通过研究这些 flow observable， 你看它有没有什么 anomaly， 有一些不正常的东西，那么呢你可以反推这个初始条件上有什么曲异的东西。这是我觉得可大家都去做这个东西呢，我觉得可以理解，因为这是一个很自然的想法。所以说有没有其他的就是说可能性去研究这个呢？对，这个这取决于，这可能也取决于一个核的具体的情况，就是说有的比如说如果说我们考虑说比如说它的 proton 的分布对某一个核它有很特别的地方的话，那么也许比如说一些磁场相关的效应呢，甚至说像对某些这种 peripheral ultra peripheral collision 呢也都会有影响。但是这个我没有去很深入的思考过，可能现在只能提供一点有限的这个想法，就是。
好，谢谢。
好，谢谢啊，今天这个金峰也给我们这个回答了好多问题，这个时间也蛮长的。那么金峰呢，反正今天是主要是讲了关于这个 Isobar 这些守增持效应。那么接下来在随后的时间里面，他还会讲关于这个rotation 的这个 polarization 这个 topic， 还有呢就是这个夸克汤里面的这个 exotic charm 的 exotic 这样的两个 seminar， 好吧。那么我们时间定下来之后随后再宣布。那么这一次感谢这个所有的老师跟同学们参与这样的一个报告，也特别感谢这个金峰给了精彩的这个报告。好，谢谢啊。好，
谢谢，
那我们这个报告就到这儿。
好，
大家再见。
哎，下次再见。
好，金峰再见。
哎，再见。
谢谢。